won that boycott, the farmers ran to the legislature and tried to create laws that would basically outlaw Bitcoin, because we used the system effectively. And we kind of looked at each other and said, man, we left a big old hole in our organizing strategy. And ever since then, we knew that once low-income people learned to play the game and were successful in organizing, that our opposition was going to come after you. And so ever since then, we've been building up our electoral piece, especially in the legislature. So we have pretty good credibility in the legislature. And, you know, for those probably know, in November of 2014, you know, we were instrumental in getting at least three Democrats elected in Peter Courtney, Betty Comp, and Paul Evans. And so as a result of that, we've gotten, we've got really good representation. So on the issues like paid sick leave, you know, our opposition came to try to exempt farm workers, right? For every little thing, you know, farm workers are exempted, right? And yet we're the most important workers in America, because we put food on people's table, but yet we're not afforded the same rights. You know, so it took the forming of a union 30 years ago, because this year we're celebrating 30 years of struggle. I want to thank Joan for being with us all those 30 years. We used one of her houses as a meeting center for the farm workers in Salem back in the late 1970s. So thank you, Joan, and also Rolando, and also John has been a really strong supporter in the most difficult times, when the mushroom plant came, were closed down, and we put 350 farm workers in the streets. You know, they formed a committee, and we fed those workers for a year and a half. You know, and we were able to get the Department of Labor to declare them, you know, to get benefits for them. And so we got benefits for the majority of those workers. But the exciting thing is that during the session, I got a call from Betty Comp, and she told me that she wasn't going to run anymore. And she didn't want to mention it publicly until we filed a campaign. So she gave me a list of names, and I had a list of names, and Bitcoin did, and so we went and we talked to people, and we told her, well, I think the person that will fit right for the House District 22 is Teresa Alonso, who's currently on the Woodburn City Council. You know, she's pro-labor, she's an educator, she's well-respected. For those that don't know, I'm also a member of the Higher Education Coordinating Council, which is kind of like the Board of Regents for the state of Oregon, to oversee the budgets from the seven universities and the 17 community colleges. And we hired her to be our new GED coordinator, and she's done a fabulous job. So she's, you know, she has a degree, she has a master's degree in education, and so she's a very, very good candidate. In addition, on last year, we were really instrumental Pecun and passing the school board bond in Woodburn for $68 million. We sold those bonds to the market and got $78 million. So 10 additional million for our kids in the Woodburn School District. And that experience really catapulted us to a different level, because we, you know, we organized house to house, precinct to precinct in Woodburn, and was able to get that bond measure passed after 10 attempts. Can you imagine? We could never get it passed because the senior staters would always vote against us. So we went to the senior staters and did an organizing campaign to convince them that it was in Woodburn's best interest for our community to pass that school bond, and we did it. So, and you know, as a result, Woodburn also went from the highest dropout rate in the state to the highest graduation rate in the state. We're number three in the country, we're in the state. And we have a 90 something percent graduation rate. Last year, in 2015, we graduated 350 Latino students from Woodburn High. We were the winners of the Ford Foundation. We were the winners of the Gate Millennium Scholarship. Excel Lopez won what will be a total of about close to $1 million scholarship. She gets a scholarship all the way till she can get a master's degree. Can you imagine? And from Woodburn, right? And we had tons of people graduate from high school. So we proved that if you invest in education, you organize parents, and you create a community, a sense of community where folks are involved with their children. You provide decent housing. I don't know if some of you seen the housing that Pecun has built in Nuevo Amanecer, and here in Salem we have Colonia Libertad, and we're also building units we have units over here in Independence and in Silverton, Sublimity and Staten. But when you provide people with affordable housing, and you know, they spend more time with their kids. Mm-hmm. And we're educating them, we're organizing them, we're talking to them about civic participation. That's why I think one of the things I think we're ready for, a few years ago what we did is we brought, instead of the Latinos coming to the Democratic Party, Marion County Democratic Party meeting here in Salem, we had the meeting in Woodburn. And we had a wonderful breakfast, and a number of you attended, along with the leaders in the community, and I think we need to break bread again.
Yes,
we're ready for that. So, because we need to keep House District 22 Democrat.
Yeah.
A little bit of background, right? You know, Matt Geiger, Republican, ran against Betty Kump and lost by about 800 votes. So we made the difference in that election. He's running again this year, but he's running as an independent. Right? We don't know who the Republican candidate. Somebody mentioned that they met the Republican candidate here.
Well, I met somebody running. He's a young man who works at gas stations.
Okay.
And then he talks. He lobbies you while you're getting your gas tank.
So Matt Geiger, what he would do, he's running under, Julie Parrish from Lake Oswego.
Wow.
Is creating this new independent party. And she's, to my knowledge, has not recruited one Democrat to the new party. But what she's doing is she's peeled off Matt Geiger from House District 22, who ran last session. And that's a plus for us, because then he's gonna get some of the Republican vote. He won't get the Latino vote because he's anti-immigrant. He's anti-immigrant. So, and he's running, so no Latino is gonna vote for him. But he divides the Republican vote. So that's good for us.
Ramon, if somebody else runs as an independent, I mean a real independent, and shows up on the ballot, would that help?
Would that divide
the Republican vote?
Yeah,
there's a party now. There's
that's right, and Matt must be running as the party guy.
So there would be a primary.
But independent is still a valid word in the electoral world, I understand. Independently, so anyone living in Waco or friends who could do that.
Well, I understand your point, but I think what we're concerned about is that if we believe we have a winning strategy, and we have enough Latinos, and we could get the Woodburn Democrats involved, the Marion County Democrats involved, because as we're recruiting people, and we're educating people to vote for House District 22. We're also telling them to vote for our local city council people too, mm-hmm. right? So we're helping each other out. So I think that this is a time that, ever in our history that we have to, the party has to unite with the Latino community. This is the time, not in words, but actually really roll up our sleeves and go to work. So we don't, so.